This is the current king of low-profile graphics cards, the RTX A2000, a magnificent stallion of a card. But because it's got the word workstation in the description, it costs $700 before tax, which is quite a lot. Luckily, there's a new contender in the form of a low-profile RTX 4060. And in today's video, I'm gonna pit them head-to-head in the deathmatch arena of death, and the victor will be crowned king of low-profile graphics cards. And here is the potential heir to the throne. Now, it's been out for a while, but I couldn't find them in stock anywhere, but they're finally available, so I bought this one, and yeah, I think it's gonna be quite a bit faster, but it may have a bit of a problem for what it is, which we'll see in a second. Wow, that is quite a cooler. We've got three of these cute, tiny little fans, which are undoubtedly real noisy once they get going. But hopefully they don't need to work too hard because we've got a pretty substantial bit of fin stack, and we've even got some heat pipes under here. So this is some beefy cooling for a low profile graphics card. In terms of IO, it's actually a lot more usable in my opinion than the A2000, because the A2000 has four mini display ports, which kind of makes it like using an Apple product. You almost always need an adapter. Whereas this has just like normal graphics card outputs. Very good, I like that. And this 4060 also comes with the low profile bracket in the box. And just like with the A2000, we don't get a backplate, which I guess means low profile graphics cards don't deserve them. Now, the aforementioned problem is that this has an 8-pin power connector, whereas the A2000 doesn't, which not only means you'll need more power supply cables, but with the 115-watt TDP of the 4060, it's also more power hungry, which could potentially limit its use cases. I don't know, let me know in the comment section down below what you think. But with that, before we have a look at the performance, let's do a quick teardown of the baby 4060. Well, it's the future now, and you know what that means. It's teardown time, and I know how this little thing performs. Oh, my favorite thing in the world, me versus a tiny fan connector. Oh! Someone did break there, but it's okay, I guess. Oh, it's so cute. It's just like a thin slice of graphics card. Here is our 8 gigs of video memory, down from the 12 gigs on the A2000, which is a bit of a bummer. Next to that, we have our AD107 die, aka the RTX 4060, which is quite small compared to the GA106 of the A2000. Other than that, I don't have a whole lot to say about it. We've got some power delivery and yeah, it's a low profile graphics card. Don't get that kind of insight anywhere else. The cooler is pretty cool. We've got two heat pipes that make direct contact with the die and spread heat around the fin stack. Memory is touched, and we've got some contact with the power delivery as well. But this is one of the beefier coolers I've seen for this form factor of GPU. But with that, let's refresh our memories on how the A2000 performs, and then we'll try out the 4060. Now at 1080p, this is where the A2000 is real happy. With Battlefield 5 running at high settings, you can see we're hovering around 120 frames per second, which is very impressive for about 70 watts of power draw. Now in terms of the test system, I've got a 13900KS and a whole bunch of RAM in here so that we don't have any CPU bottleneck during our testing. But later in the video, I will be torturing that little 4060 in an old Optiplex to see how it handles that. At 1080p high, Cyberpunk is giving us just over 50 frames per second. I almost said 60 frames per second, but I feel like that would be too charitable. But still, this is high settings, and we're not drawing 800 watts. It's pretty cool. Now with Starfield at 1080p medium settings, it's running a bit worse than Cyberpunk did, and we're getting serious frame rate dips, but it's still playable, and I'm just using a settings preset here. I'm sure with some settings optimization, you can get it to run a decent bit better. Resident Evil 4, but again, at 1080p high-ish, I guess, is again running around 60-ish frames per second. So even with these more demanding games, we're still getting a good frame rate without having to sacrifice heavily in terms of settings. Now finally, The Last of Us is a game that may potentially favor the A2000, because the version of the A2000 that I have in here has 12 gigs of video memory, whereas the RTX 4060 just has 8 gigs for some reason. But then again, the A2000 performs roughly similarly to an RTX 3050, so I think there's a good chance we have a bit of a bloodbath on our hands. But no point speculating, let's find out. Wait a minute, why is this performing the same? I mean, in this map where there's less going on, it's running a bit better, but in the standardized benchmarks, they've got the same result, basically. Is the A2000 a lot faster than I remember, or is the RTX 4060 really terrible? Let's try another game. Ooh, never mind, I take it back. In Cyberpunk, the 4060 spits in the face of the A2000. Now, it is with a decent bit higher power draw, but we were kind of expecting that, right? And the performance differential means that the 4060 holds up way better at 1440p. In fact, this result is better than the A2000's 1080p result. Yeah, I don't know what was going on with that Battlefield 5 result, but here with Starfield, again, the 4060 predictably is performing quite a lot better. I think part of the reason we're getting almost double the performance here is because the A2000 doesn't have the same consumer drivers as the RTX 4060, and the 4060 recently got a driver update that helped performance in Starfield. Oof, damn, I'm starting to feel bad for the A2000 here. This is quite the thrashing, which is interesting considering that according to Resident Evil's settings, we don't quite have enough video memory for these settings, and the A2000 did. Actually, on that note, it looks like the 4060 is having a stroke. Let me quickly restart the game. Ah, there we go, we're back, and it looks way better, and it's running very well. At 1080p high settings, despite the fact that we just have 8 gigs of video memory, we're getting some solid performance here. So clearly, unless you're looking at Battlefield 5, the 4060 is performing way better. And if you take into consideration the fact that it costs almost half as much, that's pretty wild. But with that, I'm kind of sick of how smug the 4060 is being. Let's put it in its place. The final thing I want to try is drop the little 4060 over here into the Amazon gaming system just to see how it fares in its natural environment. I've run into a teeny bit of a problem here. The power supply only has 2 SATA power connectors, and we need one of them to power the SSD. And the definitely not Savage SATA to 8-pin power adapter I'm gonna use needs an additional 2. So the savageness is gonna have to multiply a little. There we go, problem solved. Now I'm gonna be not stupid about this, but I feel like that ship has sailed. I'm gonna be less stupid about this and not use this adapter to entirely power the graphics card. I'm gonna use the splitter between the SSD and one of the graphics card connectors so that the graphics card gets like 1.5, I guess. That. Yeah, I don't know about you, but this is clearly a great idea. Oh no, I don't think this is its natural habitat. Terrible things are happening. Wait, I have to turn it off, and I think some cables are blocking fans or something. I thought it was gonna be fine, but yeah, those cables are clearly wedged in the fans. Let's see if we can fix it. Ah, wow, that's hot.
Can I just, yeah, we can just pull it out.
Woo! And after my very manly sounds, I unplugged some IO to make space for the fans to breathe a bit, which made a big difference. Oh, that's much better now. We've been gaming for a while and nothing's exploded yet, which is progress. It is very stuttery though. I think the i7-2600 in here isn't having a great time trying to keep up with the 4060. So I guess this really isn't a very good use case for it. Although on a side note, Starfield kind of runs, which is pretty cool. I wasn't expecting that with the quad core we have in here. It does do that, but aside from the apocalyptic stutters, it's kind of playable. So with that, we've got a new champion low profile graphics card, which also costs about half as much, which is very nice. I think once the current generation of low profile Optiplexes show up on the used market 5 years from now, you're gonna be able to build one hell of a gaming system out of the pair. Maybe I should do a video on that. Let me know in the comment section down below, and with that, thank you for watching, and until the next video, bye bye.